You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Sally of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
I want you to turn to somebody and say, "Let's get lit." Turn to somebody else and say, "Let's get lit." You know that's how you said it at the club last night. You can have your seat. Amen. If I did a survey and asked who's been lit before, amen, I suspect more than just my hand would go up. But y'all can pretend that since we in church that y'all saved, and that's cool. But I suspect that when you hear "let's get lit," some images immediately come into your mind. We turned up. You remember when you turned up. I can remember a time that unfortunately I was lit, and I was lit with some of the people in this room. Amen. This is back in the day. I'm not going to bust anybody out, Pastor Mark. I'm not going to bust anybody out, Pastor Mark. And I'm not going to say anybody else's name, Pastor Mark. But I've been in situations before where the Jesus in us was hidden. Amen. And the flesh was on display. Amen. But look what a mighty long way God has brought me and Pastor Mark. Amen. Not to say anybody's name. But when you think about "let's get lit," I'm sure there's an image that there's some music. There might be a soundtrack that might play in your head. There might be some images of bottles being turned up. There might be some images of dancing and moving about. And you just remember, maybe with some fondness or also with some regret. Amen. Because usually when things get lit, they also get out of control. Amen. Many times that's a path for something to get lit and to burn over and to burn out of control. But today I want to encourage us as I read Romans 15, 1 through 6, really Romans 15, 1 through 7. I was overcome with this desire to say those three words: let's get lit. Amen. Obviously not the same way that many of us have been lit before. But I am suggesting that as we talk about reigniting, that this scripture that is before us is a reminder that when we read it, we should be saying we got to get lit here. We've got to get lit. And so 2 weeks ago, when we were approving the T-shirt for the Reignite Weekend, and I saw what the text was, I just looked at it, obviously. And immediately, and I'm talking immediately, the Lord began to give me this message. And I love how the Lord does that. It's very, very encouraging. He is a God of encouragement, and he constantly lets me know, "I got you. I know you're doing Faith Lives Matter, but I need you to break off. You go to Romans 15, I got you." And I had somebody's business card in my wallet that is no longer in my wallet because now there's notes all over it. I was there and I wrote on the back of it. I ended up writing on the front of it, and I got what I needed and then began to expand and expound on it. And so when we talk about this message, I'm just excited about it because I believe God is moving. That's how he does. He does things in concert. And so you had the missions team out front, and they're praying and they're working and they're laboring to do some things. And then God gives me something to add to the mix. Amen. Add to the mix. God is a God of coordination. He likes to coordinate. Mushroom shirt, mushroom belt, special inside mushrooms. That's how our God gets down. You all remember that? Every time you see that, if you ever see Boomerang and you see that piece, I want you to think about not him. I want you to think about how God coordinates. That's how he does. Mushroom shirt, mushroom belt, special inside mushrooms. If you don't know what I'm talking about, it's okay. You just not in. It's okay. Amen. So reigniting is really about two things. I want to take a new mental image when you talk about reigniting or getting lit. It's really about contact and connection. Contact and connection. So when I think of contact, when I talk about reigniting, I want you to take a picture of a match in your head. You take that match by itself can't do anything. It's got to be struck, and it's got to go against the striking part of the matchbook, and there has to be what? physical contact. There'd be contact. And as there's interaction with the striking part of the match actually ignites. So when you think about let's get lit, I want you to keep that picture in your mind. A second picture that I want you to put in your mind is a picture of a train, a toy train, actually. Many of us had toy train sets growing up. And one of the things about that train set was that you did it. It plugged into the wall so that you could get electrical power to the tracks. And if there was ever a time where the train was not functioning correctly, then that means that there had to be a faulty what? Connection. Amen. There had to be a faulty connection. And if it was plugged right into the wall, usually what had happened is there was a wire. There's usually two of them. There was a wire that needed to be wrapped around a screw. And then you screwed that wire in. And that was what provided the source of power to the track so that the train could run. And if it was not connected, if it had frayed loose or it had come loose because you were playing or kicked it or did something, you knew that you needed to go back to and you needed to reconnect at the connection point. And you knew that if you could reconnect, then the power would flow and everything would work in terms of the train because there would be juice on the track. So when we talk about reigniting, we talk about contact, we talk about connection, and we're really trying to fan into flame what happens in verse 6, but it's really collective worship in word, deed, and voice to our God. That's the place that we're trying to get to. Collective worship in word, deed, and voice to our God. It's time to get lit. So how are we going to do that? Well, the scripture in Romans 15 gives us great encouragement and instruction around how to do what is required of us in terms of being on fire for the Lord and in our collective worship in word, deed, and voice be pleasing to our God. And it starts in verse 1. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please his neighbor for his good, to build him up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, and this is Psalm 69 and 9, taken from Psalm 69 and 9, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. I want you to, as we talk about being lit, I want you to think about the good that can be gained. There is a good that can be gained. Amen? Verses 1 through 3. I'm preaching here, so if I say something, it's okay to say amen, okay? Amen. So just so I know I'm not up here just by myself. We hear, you hear, we might as well participate. Amen? Amen. Amen. It's fun. See how fun that is? Just participate. There's a good that can be gained in this if we get lit. And here's where the good is. It says, listen, it says, we who are strong ought to bear the failings of the weak and not please ourselves. And what the Apostle Paul is encouraging us is transform yourself from one who is selfish to one who is selfless. Amen. Transform yourself from one who is selfish to one that is selfless, concerned only of you, to making you concerned and considerate of others. Amen. He says you got to literally change the way you think about how you interact. Now, the unfortunate thing is most people will read those verses and say, he's talking about me. I'm strong. Everybody else is weak. That's not necessarily true. But what he's saying is he spends all of Romans 14, and I'll let you read that on your own. Obviously, we're really talking about the weak and the strong. And there were certain issues and challenges that were being faced by those that were in Rome. He also mentions it in 1 Corinthians, particularly the example he uses about food that was sacrificed to idols. And now the Apostle Paul says, if you're strong, you understand whether you eat or what you eat, as long as you bless it and pray over it, it's good. If it's been sacrificed to somebody else, it doesn't matter. Eat the meat. But other people that have come out of really idolatrous situations and lifestyles, if they know that that meat has been sacrificed to idols, it may cause them to stumble and fall. And so he was encouraging those that were strong, those that had a real understanding that it really didn't matter. He says, listen, he said, but don't just eat meat in front of them, because they might stumble and fall. You can't let your liberty be the opportunity for somebody else to stumble. So he says, listen, you've got to be considerate of somebody else. Everything that you and I do, Romans 14 is encouraging us around a couple of things, but it says, am I doing this unto the Lord? That's the question that you could always ask. What I'm doing, whatever it is, whatever I'm pursuing, whatever I see, whatever I'm involved in, am I doing it unto the Lord? And just as importantly, am I causing anybody else to stumble? Amen. Perfect example for me and Pastor Mark is Bid Whist. Amen. We love to play Bid Whist. We used to play Bid Whist all night long if you let us. And there are other people that are out there that are like that. But there are people that are in the body of Christ that believe that card playing is sinful. That it's a waste of time, that you shouldn't do it. These are people, obviously, that don't know the true joy of Bid Whist. They just don't experience it. They're probably, you know, they play spades, that's where they stop. They're weak. They didn't move on, amen, and graduate to the power of Bid Whist, and so they don't know the joy. And so, but I remember somebody, there was the situation where somebody's parent was around, and he told us we were wasting our time playing cards, and he didn't appreciate it. And so what could we do? We could continue to play, or we could say, you know what, we can fold this up for now. We don't need to offend another believer by playing cards. Amen. And so if I'm at your house and I want to play cards and you don't think it's right to play cards, guess what? We're not playing cards. I don't need to push that. It's not that important to me to get into a discussion with you or cause you to stumble by seeing your pastor play cards. But if you come over to my house and we're having the card pool, guess what? Then you're not going to get invited, because at some point we will be playing cards. And that's the way you can kind of think about it. It's like, I'm not going to cause you to stumble. If you think that card playing is, there's nothing that you and I are pursuing that is worth making somebody else stumble. Your liberty should not make somebody else stumble. You can just say, I can do without this for now. I don't need to offend you. I need to help you, because I'm considering you more than I'm considering my what? Self. Do you realize, and we'll get to it and unfold, that it's very difficult to connect with people if you only think about yourself? Very difficult. Very difficult. It's much easier when you consider others like you consider yourself, and then you can begin to humbly connect with people, and it's purposeful. The connection is purposeful. The Apostle Paul says it's to do what? It's for their good, to build them up. It's not saying, you know, please others. It says, you know, each one should please his neighbor. You're not to please your neighbor because you're trying to manipulate them or you're trying to scheme them or do whatever. Everything you and I should do should be purposeful to build them up. Matter of fact, you remember in Ephesians 4:29, the Bible says, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth except that which is good for edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. Again, it says, be very thoughtful around your communication. Everything we should do should be able to edify somebody else. Ephesians 4:11-13 says it this way, talking about the gifts in the body of Christ. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. He says, everything that I've done in terms of giftedness in the body is so that the body can be built up. Amen. And Galatians 6:2 gives us this very simple encouragement. Carry one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ.
Galatians, and the Apostle Paul really talked a lot about the difference between the law and the Old Testament law and in this new place of grace. But he said, if you really want to fulfill the law of Christ, then you got to be able to carry one another's burdens. You can't carry somebody's burdens if you don't have contact with them and you don't have connection with them. Amen. You can't carry a burden by being up here. Amen. There are many times that when you see lifeguards, their job is to actually rescue people, amen, which means that at some point they may actually have to do what? Get in the water. And so you can. They'll work a buoy. They'll work a stick. They'll do that. But at some point there are some things that require you to actually take the little suntan lotion off of your nose, take your cool sunglasses off, and actually jump in the water and help. Amen. And that's what God is saying to you and I about this. You got to be able to connect with people. There are some things you can do from the comfort of the dock, but there's some things that are going to require you to get in the water and actually get wet. And there's a good that can be gained if you and I do that. The good is we'll transform ourselves from ones who are selfish to ones that are selfless. And on top of that, it'll be purposeful because it'll edify them and it'll be for your neighbor's good as well. But not just thinking about the good that can't be gained. I love this. And as you all know, have heard me quote it many times, this is one of my favorite verses. There's a gift that has been given. There's a gift that has been given. The things that are written aforetime were written for our knowledge, that through patience and comfort of the scriptures, we might have what? Hope. We might have hope. The things that are written aforetime were written for our learning. Amen. That we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. That is a gift that God has given us in order to help us to connect, in order to help us to be lit, in order to help us to ignite and reignite. He says, I've given you a gift already. Everything that is written in the Bible is written so that you might learn something from it. Amen. There's not a situation you'll face in your life that you can't go to the scriptures and find some encouragement and comfort from somebody else's situation there, or some direct command from God, or some direct encouragement from one of the apostles. There are so many patterns and practices in scripture that there's not a situation where you can look and say, I can't find anything in scripture that helps me with that. There's no situation, y'all not listening to me. There's no situation in your life. You trying to decide how you're doing well at work and trying to decide there's some career things. If you can't appreciate somebody career-minded like Daniel and study how you handle that, you're missing out. If you are controlling, you don't know how to behave, you got to check out my man Joseph. You just have to. The three Hebrew boys, you got to know how to stand up when somebody is telling you that they need you to do something, but God has told you something different. Then you look at the three Hebrew boys and you say, I know I got to have a faith like that. There's not a situation in your life that you will face, a trial that you will face, that God has not already given you some comfort in the scriptures from. So what do you and I have to do? If you want to be comforted by the scriptures, baby, you got to know the scriptures. In Acts chapter 17, the scripture says this about the Bereans. It says, now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Say, yeah, I heard what you said. I'm encouraged by what you said, but I want to study it for myself. Got to get it for myself. Got to get it. So then when you look at 2 Timothy 2:15, then you know what? Come on, Awana people, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You got to study. You got to be in this thing. There's nothing bad that's going to ever happen to you studying the Bible more. Amen. That if you study the Bible an extra hour a week, versus whatever you're doing. Just give me an hour. I guarantee you your life will be exponentially better in that hour and because of that hour than anything else you and I could do. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Why? Because all scripture is given what inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for instruction, and for instruction, correction, and righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. There is no better investment that you can make in the gift that has already been given. Amen? The gift that has already been given. And then what I'm saying is, as it relates to how we act and how we interact, how we contact, how we connect, we can bear the burdens of others because we experience and know the encouragement, comfort, and endurance that we have received from God. How do you receive endurance? By studying the scriptures. Because you can see the examples of others and how God in his infinite wisdom took them up and down and in and out, and things happened to them. And you can say, maybe it just doesn't always, again, you can't just plant and harvest in the same season. You can see examples of that over and over and over. You can even see examples of endurance that you may not like Jeremiah, who literally preached for 40 years and by all measures, nothing good happened for him. No change, nobody got converted, nobody got saved, nobody turned their life around, but God was doing something in Jeremiah that is of benefit to us because we see his endurance. We see that despite all that he went to, he could say, great is thy faithfulness. Amen? You got to be encouraged by that. Because the likelihood that you'll face some dark days when everything doesn't go right for you, even when you do right, it's pretty great. And you can read Lamentations chapter 3, and you can see how Jeremiah said, it feels like, it's like, you know, something's happening in my bones. It's like my teeth are broken. But this one thing I remember, it is of the Lord's mercies that I am not consumed, for they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. And if Jeremiah can say that, you got to be able to say that. That's endurance, beloved. There's comfort to know that you're not the only one that has had a particular trouble, a particular challenge. All of those things are available from the Word of God, because if we know and study the Word of God, then out of our fullness, we can minister to others. Never mind the fact that in 2 Corinthians it says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all of our tribulation, that we may be to comfort them which are in any trouble by the same comfort wherewith we are comforted of God. Same comfort. See, you gave it to me, I give it to you. Amen? He's a God of comfort. And so that's really the gift that's been given. God never requires something from you without giving you the tools to get it done. Amen? Because otherwise that would be inconsistent with his character. He's not going to demand that you do something and say, no, but I've given you everything you need. If you just open up my step-by-step kit here and you just follow the instructions, you will be able to accomplish what I asked you to do. Amen? I've given you everything you need. It's right there. I've given you my spirit. I've given you my word. I've given you the fellowship of other believers to help you get it done so that you don't have to do it by yourself. And if you all would just follow my guidebook, not my rule book. If you just follow my guidebook, guess what? You'd be just fine. This is a gift. It's a gift that has been given. And so when you understand that, for everything was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through an endurance and encouragement of scriptures, we might have hope. Now check this out. Verse 5 says, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you. Amen. So this sounds like the bonus. Amen. Already gave you a gift, but just like those infomercials say, but wait. There's more. If you act now, in the next 60 seconds, and they put that clock down in 60 seconds, it starts counting down, we will double your order. not only will you get two for $19.99, you will get four for $19.99. But wait, there's more. If you act now, literally in the next 10 seconds, we'll throw in free shipping and handling. That was overpriced and it has nothing to do with what we're selling you in the first place. But if you act now, not only will we give you four, we'll give you four with free shipping and handling. You say, I got to do that deal. Got to do that deal. So here's a God who's already said, I've given you the gift of everything that has been written aforetime so that you can learn, and with patience and comfort of scriptures that you might have hope that you can do the same, that you can endure, that you can comfort others, that you can minister, that you can do all of that. But wait, there's more. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement, he's already given that, give you this, a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ. It's something that he will grant you. That's what the scripture says in the King James, something he'll grant you. That's the third thing that I want you to remember. There is a grace that must be grasped. Amen. There's a grace from God. You've got to grasp it. When I say grasp it, I literally mean you need to grasp it conceptually, and then you've got to grasp it practically. Amen. There's something that God is saying that will really be helpful for you. And he says, I've granted that to you. I want you to grasp it. It's out there. It's available to you, but it's something you have to grasp. It's this concept called unity. If you really want to get lit, you got to unify with the rest of the body of Christ. You got to unify with your brothers and sisters, and you have to do it to give you that spirit of unity among yourselves, and you do it as you follow Christ. My friend and pastor Kenny Grant used to be from Savannah, Georgia. He used to be a Marines drill sergeant. Okay, good grief. That's I'm scared now. But Brother Matthew, he's always been very scary to me. Now I'm very scared. Marines, he told me this, and as a drill sergeant, you know, one of the first basic things you learn is you got to learn how to march. Got to learn how to march. And so the big thing is that most guys think that they have to do, and it seems pretty simple, is you just need to be in pace and on the same beat as the person right in front of you. That's a kind of a simple thing. He steps, you step. Boom, 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 boom. And so that's really the first thing. And you get that, but Pastor Grant would tell you they're not in unity. They could be in unity, but they have not achieved the objective, because they're unified together, if they're not marching with me, then the whole thing's wrong anyway. If they're off beat with me, even if all of them are on the same page together, it's not enough to be on the same page with somebody else in the body of Christ if we're not on the same page with the one we're supposed to be following. So you have to be on page with him, and you have to be on the same page with those that are marching with you. Amen. And so that's the same thing as saying, hey, we're all singing the same words at the same time. But if we're not on beat with what the musicians are playing, it's still going to be off. And so you and I have to press for unity together. Amen. Unity of spirit, unity of purpose. But we've got to follow Jesus Christ. That's the grace that has to be grasped. Got to grasp that unity. The scripture says it in 1 Peter 2:21, to this you were called because Jesus Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. Amen. Got that march thing going. Follow in his steps. March together, but you better be marching with him. Romans 12:16 says it this way, live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Uh-oh. We're finding, wait a minute, have we just stumbled onto really how to connect with somebody else and transform yourself from being selfish to selfless? I think we have. let's nail it all the way down and go to Philippians chapter 2, 3 and 4, which really talks about an action and an attitude and an activity that you have to have if you're going to be unified. And if you look at Philippians chapter 2, it really is talking all about unity. That's really the focus of the encouragement in that chapter. And there's a fulfillment of that encouragement that's right there, and these are those verses that I'm talking about. He says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, any comfort from his love, if you have any fellowship with the Spirit, any tenderness or compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded. Paul says, hey, the first chapter was all about your joy. Now I want to tell you a little bit about what would bring me a little joy. If you would be like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. How you do that? What's the fulfillment of that? How would you do that? He says it, verses 3 and 4. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. You cannot make a connection if you are proud. Humility is the best lubricant for connection. It's the best way to get connected to somebody else is to consider them just as much or more than you consider yourself. Amen? To realize that you're not as high as you think you are, but that you people of low estate doesn't mean they're low. That doesn't mean they don't have value. You can learn just as much from somebody of quote unquote low estate than you can dealing with somebody. We're always looking up. We're always trying to climb up. God says, I'm not interested in you climbing up as much as I am you reaching down. Somebody who's in a bad situation, somebody who has had some hard times and some tough times, that's how you know that you're connecting with people. Everybody wants to make the connections with the people at the top. They know it too. And that's why they take your little business card and they hear you and they throw it in a pile someplace and they never call you back. Amen. I spend most of my day at my day job in private equity begging for money because we're trying to raise a fund. And the people that have the money, everybody's asking them for money. And you're trying to come up with cute little ways. Remember we met at the such and such, and then you said that your son played baseball? My son played baseball. Remember when we had talked, we had laughed about the baseball? He ain't seen no money yet. Amen. But you're trying to make a connection. You're always trying to make a connection, but I can guarantee you, if you begin to reach back, you begin to quote unquote reach down, you begin to reach behind, you make all kind of connections with all kind of folks. Amen. Because then you realize that you're helping somebody up and that you're giving them value, or you're acknowledging the value, excuse me, that's already in them. Amen. So the Apostle Paul says, listen, this is a grace that needs to be grasped. You got to be unified. And the way that you get unity is through humility. Amen. So the real question is, how low can you go? All the way to the flow? Can you go down low all the way to the flow? Yeah, you can. With humility, you can. If you're not vain and conceited, but you say, listen, I am going to do what? I am going to go with those that are quote unquote of lower state, but do nothing out of selfish ambition. Me sending that email talking about, that's all, it's corporate ambition. It's selfish, but it's corporate. Because I really don't care that his son plays baseball. I just need to get the money. Amen? That's acknowledged ambition. But you should be connecting with people, particularly in the body of Christ and particularly in your relationship, where you're not trying to get anything from them. You're trying to give them something that God has given you, because through patience and comfort of the scriptures, you have hope. So now you're trying to transmit hope. You're trying to make connection with other folks. Whether those folks live on 16th Place, whether those folks live on Hickory, whether those folks live on Scott Street, whether those folks live over here, whether those folks live on Lincoln Highway, we should be making connections with people all around us, because we have something of value that God has given to us that we can minister with to other people. We should be giving it away, giving hope away, giving transformation away, because we have aligned ourselves with what? truth. And when you have that truth, you should be able to share that truth with others. 1 Peter 1:22 says, now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love of your brothers, love one another deeply from the heart. He said, now that you have the truth, now that you've studied the truth, now that you know the truth, now that you've embraced the truth, and that truth is literally a person in Jesus Christ, now that you understand the gospel, here's what I need you to do. I need you to go out and beat everybody over the head with it and tell them they're all going to hell because you found the truth and they haven't found it yet. That's what you do. It's not what it says. He says, now that you know the truth, now that you've been put on, now love one another deeply from the heart. Because that's going to show, by this men shall know that ye are my disciples if ye have love one for another. If the love is present, that's what's going to draw the people. That's what makes connection. That's what allows you to be humble. Amen? That's what allows you to follow through in that regard. And so it's not just the gift that has been given, which is just powerful. It's not the good that can't be gained. It's not just the grace that must be grasped. If we're going to be effective, that's the grace that must be grasped. This last thing is in verse 6. It says this very simply, so that with one heart and mouth you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the goal that should be gotten. That's the goal. That's the goal. That's the goal. And you know what? I would say the Christian life is again, and you know, it's all about God's what? Glory. Glory is what is due him. That word in the Greek meaning doxa. Or that word in the Greek is doxa. And part of that is, again, it's about thinking and recognizing. So when you literally say, you better recognize, God can say that. You better recognize. That's what glory is. You better recognize. Recognize. Think about it. And if once you think about it, then our response has got to be, oh, shoot, I got to give him glory. There's an action that gets attached to that because I realize his state. I realize how awesome he is. I realize who he is in his person. I realize what he's done and all that he's done for me. And I give him praise for what he's done, but I give him glory for who he is. I've acknowledged, I've thought about it, and the scriptures help me to do that. And my connection with other people, and as I walk this earth, and I get the comfort and endurance from him, it helps me to glorify him more. That's the goal that has to be gotten. It literally is, God's got a glory initiative. Amen? It's all about his glory. And he says, I want to see my glory initiative spread. And so if it spreads and it turns into, from a fire to literally a wildfire, I'm happy because that's more people acknowledging and recognizing what the truth is, which is I am God all by myself and my glory I will not give to another. It's a glory thing. It's a glory initiative. Amen. And so I want you to understand that in this glory initiative, you need us like any other fire. There's really three things you need for a fire. You need a spark, you need a source, and you need a sight. Amen. You need a spark. Something's got to happen. That's why whether it's the matches to strike, the strike block, whether it's a lighter, they got to have something, that flint, that something that gives that spark. But with the association of the spark, you also have to have a source of what? A source of fuel so that the spark can actually light. But the spark for us is the knowledge that we need to be connected, that we need to give him glory, that's really what this whole thing is all about, that we're a part of a glory initiative. That spark is the spark of knowledge. Now you need a source, amen, to fuel what you know you need to do. And God steps in and says, everything you need to bring me glory, I've put in you or put around you or given to you in the word, in the people, in my very spirit, so that that source can burn forever. Amen. You can get all that you need. Once you got the spark of knowledge, I come right in with the source. Now I'm just looking for a sight. Where can I burn this that I maximize my glory? What is my locus of focus? Where am I going to do it? Where do I want to do it? Where it will maximize my glory. I want to do it, God says, in the local church. Every community has a church. And if we spread the gospel around the world, that there should be local bodies everywhere. And so in this location, who will God use to bring him glory? He's looking. I see a location. I see a locus of focus at 1645 Wilson. Now, that 1645 Wilson location in Chicago Heights, 60411 zip code, will not be able to do anything for Lake Forest. But I got Lake Forest covered. I got Barrington covered. I got areas of Chicago covered. I got Dalton covered. I got South Holland covered. I got Arkansas covered. I got California covered. I got other places. But I need some coverage right there in Chicago Heights at 1645 Wilson. Who can I get to light a flame right there so that it will burn so that I can have a site? I need a glory initiative headquarters in Chicago Heights. And we say, what? It's us, Lord. Use us. Use us right here so that we can affect our area. That's what the local church is supposed to do. We're supposed to light and reignite a fire in this community. And if we do it, and the church across the street, New Life Baptist, does it, and then we can burn up both of these sides of the street. And then we connect with the other churches, another church that's over here. And then if they're doing it like they're supposed to, and they're responding the way God they're supposed to, now we've burned up this whole little area. And if we can keep connecting local churches, all of a sudden, next thing you know, this thing spreads like a wildfire, and God is glorified. But you can't have connection with another body until you light the church fire here. And that means we have to connect with one another, and we have to connect with those that are right around us in our community. That means we have to reach out. There has to be contact and connection. Otherwise, the fire won't spread. And God is looking to burn up the entire world euphemistically and metaphorically with the fire of his glory. But it has to start somewhere, and it starts with us. It starts in us and what he wants to do in us, and then it moves to what he wants to do around us. And so we need to start burning a fire for him, and that fire looks like what? One heart, one mouth. Glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's not just the voice. It's not praise and worship just with our lips. It's with our lives. It's with our lives. It's with our lives. Burn up this whole place for Jesus. Individually, and then corporately here, and then in this community, and then connecting with other churches. And the next thing you know, we see change and transformation all around us because we are literally lit. And there's nothing stopping us from being lit except the people that are in this room. And there's nothing more that God wants to use to start the fire than the people in this room. It's the same, the same solution is the same. It's the same problem, same solution. It's us. He wants to use us. The problem is what? Us. And if we can get away from ourselves long enough to get that, let that spark go with that source and use this site, we'll burn up this world with his glory. We will. We got to get ourselves out of the way. And we have to connect with one another, and we have to connect with those around us in humility so that we might be able to do what God has called us to do, which is to further his glory initiative in this place. So let's get lit. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you.